I am a school survivor. I did well, and I made my parents proud. But it came at a cost. In a system built on compliance and compulsion and competition, doing well required me to betray my inner child, my curiosities, my need for connection. Why? Why did I need to survive this experience when schooling should be about thriving? And what happens to all those people who don't manage to survive it? These are the questions that held me when I went to go and study education. I didn't learn very much there. But there was one unforgettable, life-changing line. It says, "Learning is the relatively permanent change in knowledge, skill, or ability through experience." Can you see how that's life-changing? If learning is relatively permanent change, what had I just done for 12 years at school? Because I did no relatively permanent change learning. My process was learn for the test, write the test, forget about it. In fact, that was the process at school, like 30 years ago, and not much has changed. It disturbed me that there's no escaping this institution, this place of learning, where millions of children are forced into, and where very little learning happens, and that it consumes so much of our time for 12 to 15 years. So I had to survive this place, and my learning was minimal. How does this institution hold so much power? And what is its relationship to learning, to education, and to society? I had to step out of the institutional learning box and create my own learning journey. This journey consisted of books, of blogs, of videos, and I found multiple learning communities to connect with. These learning communities ranged from families that had stepped out of the schooling system, people involved with self-directed learning centers, community learning spaces, and ecoversities. And from this experience, I learned that my path had to be something else. But before I go there, this experience of mine, where my learning journey, is what learning journeys generally look like when people own their learning. There's intrinsic motivation. There's access to resources. There's freedom to ask our questions, to create our journeys, to go slow and to go fast, and freedom to choose our teachers. This is what learning in freedom looks like. Also, I learned a few things. I got some answers. My vision of education started forming into one that needed to be rooted in children's rights, geared towards social transformation, and decolonization. For us, what that looked like was unschooling, a practice of learning and living in freedom through partnership and through community. Incidentally, the process that brought me to unschooling, that reflecting on my learning and what kind of values and principles I extract from the learning and the conscious action I take as a result, that's education. That process of constant reflection towards conscious action, that's what separates learning from education. An education is a wholly internal process. Nobody can give us an education or tell us what values and principles to extract from our learning. Each of us would create our own education, shaped by our environments and shaped by the access we have to resources. And we have a right to education. It's a human right that has been recognized by a number of international conventions. But it's different from other rights. This right is compulsory to exercise. Yep, you heard me right. It's a compulsory right. It's also a restricted right. So what our right to education looks like currently is that it's compulsory to exercise through compulsory schooling. Where's the freedom in that? That's education conscription, 12 years of compulsory service where our minds are conditioned to a particular outcome. Or as Sir Ken Robinson so eloquently says, mining our minds. Compulsory schooling is a very narrow and restricted practice. It says no to all the rich ways in which we learn. It says no to us exploring our curiosities. Instead, it confines us into the classroom and restricts the range of knowledge we can access. In this form, compulsory schooling is a violation of our right to education. With this one compulsion begins a whole slippery slew of a whole lot of other violations. That horrid school uniform. Always wrong for the weather, reinforcing the gender binary, inspection, hair, nails, makeup, jewelry, all the things I'm doing right now that I shouldn't have then. It was dehumanizing. And we were never free to pee when we needed to. What was with that? Whenever there is coercion, there's oppression. And compulsory schooling in this form is a tool of oppression. What we've inadvertently created in our dehumanization of young people is yet another marginalized community. How many of us are willing to go back to that child status and experience that level of dehumanization again? How many of us practice that dehumanization on the young people in our lives? I try not to. And then there's, you know, that phrase, don't treat me like a child. I'm not a child. What are we saying? We're saying, don't disrespect me. Don't tell me how I'm feeling or how I should respond to how I'm feeling. Don't dehumanize me. So why is it okay for children to be treated like this? It gets worse. Children also learn that they are a despised community. That word child is often used as an insult. The word childish is generally a negative descriptor. And children hear this about themselves. They read it, they see it on the media. We even say these things to them. Dr. Stacy Patton is a child rights advocate, and she's one of a number of scholars that points to a disturbing link between the oppression of children and the society we end up with as a result. Which is why, for me, how we live with and how we educate children is a social justice concern. She says, you can't reproduce any order of societal oppression based on race, class, gender, or sexuality without first destroying every generation of young people as soon as they enter the world. And sadly, all of us experience the societal oppression. And then, with deep, deep love and the best of intentions, we send the next generation through the same experience. We put them in schools where they're learning is disrupted, where their right to education is violated, and we join schools in dehumanizing them. Is this really the experience we want for young people? Do we like the society we end up with as a result? I don't. I think our society is violent, destructive, and broken, and crying out for us to break the cycle. And we can break the cycle. We can. We can break the cycle by removing schooling as a tool of oppression and replacing it with education as a practice of freedom. We can refrain from powering over young people and partnering with them instead. We can break the cycle by minimizing individual competition and embracing community collaboration. What could emerge as a result? Multi-streams instead of mainstream, wholeness instead of trauma, and learning communities instead of learning hierarchies. If I am whole and unbroken, and each of us here is whole and unbroken, then the community we form together is whole and unbroken. And it is from whole and unbroken communities that we can all thrive. I am because we are. In South Africa, we call that Ubuntu. So education as a practice of freedom underpinned by the values of Ubuntu and Ubuntu pedagogy. Yes? I'm here to invite you to reimagine learning, to reimagine education, to reimagine community. Because on the other side of this reimagining lies a beautiful child-honoring world. Let's meet there. Thank you.